if it was going to be a cold winter or not. And not really knowing the answer, the chief replied that the winter was going to be cold and that the natives of the members of the village needed to go and collect wood. And being a good leader as he was, he went to a local phone booth and he called the National Weather Service and asked them, is it going to be cold this winter? And the man on the phone responded that the winter was going to be quite cold indeed. And so the chief went back to speed up his people to collect even more wood. And a week later, he asked the National Weather Service again, is it going to be a cold winter? And they replied on the phone, yes, it is. And so the chief went back to his people and he ordered them to get every piece of wood that they could find, every scrap of wood that they could find. And 2 weeks later, he called the National Weather Service again and he said to them, are you absolutely sure that it's going to be a cold winter? And the man on the phone said, absolutely. And the chief said, well, how do you know for sure? And the man on the phone said, well, the natives are collecting wood like crazy. And it is definitely a cold winter. Romans chapter 3, verse number 9. And notice what the Bible says together. Romans 3, verse 9. What then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before proved, both Jews and Gentiles, that they are all under sin. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that seeketh, there is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way, they are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher, and their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know, verse 19, that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. I take the title of my message this morning from verse number 19, and that is simply this, all the world guilty before God. Let's pray together, can we? Father, I pray you would help us as we study your word together. And Lord, we have gathered together this morning because we desire to know more about you. And Father, we want to know more about ourselves. And Lord, the Bible is a mirror. It reveals to us how you see us, the perspective of God in every area of our life. And so, Father, I pray that you would help us to see with eyes of faith, help us to understand. I pray you would bind Satan and his demons. I pray that your word would fall on good ground and that it would spring up and grow. And help me, Father, I pray to say, Lord, what you would have me to say. Take away from my mind that which you would have me not to say. And Father, may you be glorified with my efforts this morning. I pray that the word of God would be glorified in our hearts. And I pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. How is an individual saved? How does an individual have eternal life? Well, the Bible teaches us that it begins by first understanding their condition. What is sin? Well, the world would call sin an accident, but God calls it an abomination. Man calls it a defect, God calls it a disease. Man calls it an error, God calls it enmity. Man calls it liberty, God calls it lawlessness. Man calls it a trifle, God calls it a tragedy. Man calls it just a mistake, God calls it a madness. Man calls it a weakness, God calls it a willfulness. Sin has severe consequences. Colossians chapter 3, verse 25, you could write that verse down. The Bible says, but he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. In fact, James writes for us that the finished consequence of sin is actually death. How can one be saved? Well, first of all, they must understand their condition before God. And then they must come to Christ, Christ exclusively, for eternal life. There must be the knowledge of sin before an individual knows the Lord Jesus. And that's what Paul is spending this time in this passage of Scripture about, is helping people to understand their condition before God. The knowledge of sin is revealed in the law of God. We notice number one in our notes this morning, number one, the consistency of human sin. Now, in our passage of Scripture, we note the constant repetition, none or no, not one, in our text. The Bible makes it very clear that not a single member of Adam's ruined race is omitted. The accusation is sweeping, comprehensive, and all-inclusive. Every single individual have sinned before God. Now, Paul the Apostle breaks this down into two aspects for us. We see, first of all, the racial aspect in verse number 9. He says, what then? Are we better than they, that is the Jew, better than the Gentile? No, in no wise, for we have proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. Now, in our text, these individuals believe that because they were Jews, they had a certain heritage, that they were not sinners, that they did not have the same condemnation as the Gentiles, which we reread about in Romans chapter 1. But in this scripture, Paul makes it clear that every man, every woman, every boy and girl, every individual in this world, they are all guilty before God. No matter the language they speak, no matter the color of their skin, no matter their heritage, every man is guilty before God. 2 years ago, I had the wonderful privilege to travel to Senegal, West Africa on a missions trip. And my wife and I, we enjoyed this opportunity. We had the opportunity to be involved in various ministries and to preach the gospel. And the reality is, those poor people in Senegal, West Africa, they are guilty before God. Many years ago, I had the opportunity to, when I was youth pastor here at Kitchener Baptist Church, had the opportunity to take some teenagers to Quebec City, and that province in Canada, very much blinded with religion, had the opportunity to pass through some John and Romans and talk to some people about the Lord, and had the opportunity to preach in a service. And the reality is, those people in Quebec City, they need the gospel. They are guilty before God. And that's what the Bible is teaching us. The racial aspect is, no matter your heritage, no matter your nationality, no matter the country that you were born, the Bible says all men have sinned. Every single individual in this world, we are all guilty before God. And the Jew is not better than the Gentile. The Canadian is not better than the American. Or that individual that is in Africa is not better than the one in Quebec City. All of us are on flat ground. We are all guilty before God. That's what we find in this passage of Scripture. But then Paul takes it a step further. Not only do we notice the racial aspect, but he says also there's the religious aspect in verses number 10. Look what the Bible says, verse 10 to verse 12. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Now, let me make this clear. Keeping the law does not save an individual. This so-called religious or righteous individual, in their eyes, they cannot be saved by doing specific rituals or works. The Bible makes that very clear. Not by works of righteousness which I have done. It is by the grace of God and the work of Christ and the work of Christ only. But Paul tells us in this passage of Scripture, he's really revealing for us the fallacy in religion and the need, and let me say this, the preciousness of the gospel of Jesus Christ. What does he tell us? Well, he says, number one, that men are unrighteous. Men are unrighteous. The Bible says there is none righteous, no, not one. In fact, if we want to take
this idea even further, and I believe we should, if we want to look from God's eyes, what we would call our righteousness this morning, the Bible says that God looks at our righteousness, or what we would call our righteousness, and he says it's nothing more than filthy rags. So from God's perspective, every man is guilty, every man has sinned against God, and there is none righteous, no, not one. Not a single person is holy, not a single person is sinless, not a single person is perfect, not a single person in this world, not a single person is guiltless before God. Every man is a sinner. Now, in chapter 3, verse 10, I believe the thought that Paul is pulling from is Psalm chapter 14 and verse 3. Let's turn there this morning if we could. Psalm 14, chapter 14, and verse number 3. Notice what the Bible says. Psalm chapter 14 and verse number 3. The Bible says they are all gone aside. They are all together become filthy. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. No one is righteous before God. By nature and by choice, all men are sinners. And so the Bible says, first of all, that everyone, all men are unrighteous. But also we notice, number two, that men are unreasonable. Now the Bible says that there is none that understandeth. The word there, understandeth, it means to put things together. Let me give you a couple of verses. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. The Bible says, but the natural man, or the unsaved man, receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Colossians chapter 1, verse 21. And you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. You see, there are so many philosophies in the name of religion today. And I'm sure that you've heard many philosophies when it comes to eternal life or salvation. Maybe you've heard this philosophy. Well, it doesn't matter what you believe as long as you're sincere. The reality is that you can be sincere, but you can be sincerely wrong. And if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, the Bible says all men are unrighteous and all men are unreasonable. And human philosophies don't save an individual. It's through Jesus and Jesus Christ alone. Another individual may come to you with this philosophy. They'll say, well, you know, I've turned over a new leaf in my life. And that's their definition of eternal life. Salvation is not turning over a new leaf. Salvation is coming to Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Can you imagine if a businessman accepted that philosophy in business? I mean, can you imagine if a debtor came to him or an individual owed him money and you know, he wrote them this letter? The surprise in this man's face when he opened his mail the morning and received the letter, something like this: Dear sir, I realize that I owe you $5,000, but today I turned over a new leaf in my ledger and intend from now on to pay my debts and line up to the highest standards of business integrity. Any obligations incurred from now on will be met in full. I am ignoring the past sincerely. You know, I don't think that would fly. Let me give you a verse, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. Turn there in your Bible, Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse number 15. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse number 15. Look what the Bible says in this passage of Scripture. Verse 15, that which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been. And God requireth that which is past. God requireth that which is past. In other words, past sins still must be paid in full. The reality is that turning over a new leaf or being sincere or all the philosophies that man has to define their own salvation does not save an individual. The Bible says that man is unreasonable in his attitude toward God, because here is the key: man doesn't truly understand how ugly and how dark and how disgusting sin is to a holy God. The Bible says that man is unreasonable. In verse 11, the Bible says that men, they are unresponsive. They do not seek after God. Someone said that that word seek there, it's defined, it means to seek out after or to seek for. And it's interesting because the word there means to be determined to search after something. Men seek after religion. Men seek after their own needs for salvation, but they do not seek after the true living God. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 20, but I say that the things which the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils. They do not seek after the true God. And the Bible says if you seek him, he will be found. But we find in this passage of Scripture, they do not seek the Lord. Men are unrepented. Number 4, verse 12, they are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Unprofitable means to be useless. And a life without God, a life without Christ, is a life that is empty. It is a life that is useless. You could have all of the religion and all the ritual and all the tradition in your life that you want, but a life that is minus God equals nothing. Equals nothing. The Bible says that they are unrepentant. They become unprofitable in their search for their own means to gain eternal life. They are unprofitable. They are all gone out of the way. The Bible says there is none that doeth good. No, not one. And so we notice that all men are guilty before God. This is how God looks at humanity. Number 2, we notice the criminality of human sin. The criminality of human sin. How do sinful men act in this world? Paul continues his thought, verse number 13. He says, their throat is an open sepulcher, and their tongues, they have used deceit, and the poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. We notice, first of all, man's wicked words. They are like the vileness of a sepulcher. They are like the vileness of the sepulcher. The mouth of man is like an open grave. It is corrupt. The thought was probably taken from Psalm chapter 5, verse number 9. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulcher. They flatter with their tongue. The psalmist has the sin of deceit, the falsehood, and the slander of humanity in view in this passage of Scripture. The mouth of the sinner is slanderous and corrupt. I just read in the news a couple of days ago, the story of a young man who was in college and he was going to be a football star. And, various colleges were looking at him and he was going to receive a scholarship and he had his life made. And there was a young woman that he had in his life, and she lied and said that he raped her. And he went to prison for 6 years. And then just recently, about 2 weeks ago, she wrote a post on Facebook saying that she made it all up. And, he was a free man. But I say to you that we find what's in the heart of man. And we find what's in the heart of man. The psalmist here is revealing the slander and the corruptness and the deceit that is in the tongue of man. And this is not new. This happens all over this world. Every single day, we find the vileness of the sepulcher. We see that they are like the venom of the serpent in verses 13. Their throat is an open sepulcher. Their tongues, they have used deceit, and the poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. The picture here is rather graphic. Someone pointed out that the fangs of a deadly serpent lie originally folded back in its upper jaw, but when it throws up its head to strike, those hollow fangs drop down, and with the serpent bites, the fangs press a sack of deadly poison hidden under its lips at the root, thus injecting the venom into the womb. You and I were born with moral poison sacks like this, he lists in his commentary. We strike at another with venomous words. We strike, our speech is offensive to God. This is how God is looking at humanity. Now you think about it, a holy God who in God there is no darkness at all, and he's looking at humanity and all that is happening in our world today. How does he describe humanity? He says that their vileness is like a sepulcher, and he says they're like the venom of a serpent. Matthew chapter 12, verse 26, the Bible says, but I say unto you, that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account, therefore, in the day of judgment. How many words do you think we speak a day? A lot of words. You know, the reality is, at the end of an individual's life, they probably have volumes of words that have been spoken. Probably as many or more as a college library. Word after word that has been spoken. God records these words. In fact, the Bible says in Psalm 139, actually, let's turn there this morning, Psalm 139. We have time. It's really cold outside anyway. You probably don't want to go outside. Psalm 139 and verses number, verse 1 to 6. Look what the Bible says. God records these words and these thoughts even behind the words. Psalm 139, verse number 1. The Bible says, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down sitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Now think about that expression there. God knows our words altogether. In other words, God doesn't just know the words we say, but God knows even the thoughts behind the words that we say. God knows the words, and God knows the thoughts behind the words. Our world takes God's name in vain a lot, don't they? And the reality is they do not know the God that they speak about. Speaking his name in a blasphemous way to vent their anger and to vent their frustration. The Bible makes it clear in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 11, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. Be careful, I say to you, Christian, be careful of even variations of words that really have the root of blasphemous toward God. Be careful about the words that we say. Let no corrupt communication proceed of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. God knows our words altogether. So maybe before we speak, we should think. The Bible tells us that the words of man is like the poison of a serpent. But also he continues in this thought. He talks about man's, not only his wicked words, but also his wicked ways. In verse 15, the Bible says, their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God. There is no fear of God before their eyes. He lists the ways of man. And number one, he speaks of murder. He says their feet are swift to shed blood. It's interesting that in our Bible, the very first recorded sin, other than the sin of Adam and Eve in the beginning, the first recorded sin was that of murder. The Bible says that man is swift to shed the blood of another individual. It is easy to be complacent and to be smug when we read this passage of Scripture and think to ourselves, well, I've never committed murder. I've never done that. But that's not the point that Paul is making in this passage of Scripture. His point is that the human heart is heir to every imaginable crime. That's the point he's trying to make. The Lord Jesus traced idolatry to a lustful look, murder to an angry thought. And where the root is, it is God's restraining grace which prevents the full harvest of the fruit. And the Bible tells us in this passage of Scripture that man is swift to shed innocent blood. We see not only murder, but also misery, verse 16. He says, destruction and misery are in his ways, and the way of peace have they not known. Destruction and misery are in their ways. From figures furnished from the United Nations organization, it is estimated that during World War II, 32 million people were killed on the battlefield. Some 25 million died in bombing raids. 25 million died in concentration camps. And more than 29 million people were wounded. When we consider enlightened 20th century man's inhumanity to man, we put such figures out of our minds because we can no longer cope with the enormity of statistics involved. It is estimated that it cost $225,000 to kill an enemy soldier during World War II. And that the war cost the Allies a total of $800 billion. And despite the machinery and all of the things set up to arbitrate international problems at the conference table, man cannot find peace in this world. Someone said, I rest beneath Almighty shade. My griefs aspire, my troubles cease. Thus, Lord, on whom my soul is stayed, will keep me still in perfect peace. The reality is that peace is more than just a tranquility in our heart. Peace is something that exceeds war and trouble. Peace that we find is the rest that we have in our heart, that God is in control, in control. At the close of World War II, General Douglas MacArthur said this. He said, we have had our last chance. If we do not now devise some greater and more equitable system, Armageddon will be at our door. The problem basically is theological and involves a spiritual recudilance and improvement of human character. It must be of the spirit if we are to save the flesh. And my friend, the reality is that this is the human heart. This is what the Bible has been saying all along, that this is the core of man. Men are sinners, and murder and misery is in their path and in their heart and in their way. And the fruits of these things come to the surface in our world time and time again. And if men are going to have peace, oh, I know they search for peace here and there, but if men are going to have peace, they're going to find peace in Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ alone. That's what the Bible says. Not only do we notice in this passage of Scripture, not only is there murder, not only do we find misery, but also notice mutiny in verse 18. The Bible says there is no fear of God before their eyes. There is no fear of God before their eyes. I've never seen a day as in 2016 where men fear God so little. You know, the reality is the presence of God, holy, perfect, and pure. The presence of God ought to inspire men to forsake evil in their life. And yet, as they live their life, not towards reverence to God, but toward rage toward God, the reality is that they live their life as if God doesn't exist. And we find this mutiny, that there's no fear of God before God. And that's our world today. Murder and misery and mutiny. And we see it over and over again. Let me give you my third point and I'll be done this morning. I want us to notice the culpability of human sin. The culpability of human sin. Verse 20, the Bible says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. We find A, the law shows man's condition is helpless. He is convicted. He is convicted. The law exposes human conduct. Now, the law in this passage of Scripture mentioned here seems to be the entire Old Testament revelation. And Paul has just been referring to 14 sweeping statements of Scripture on the subject of human sin. I mean, think about it. Romans 3, verses 10 to 18. There are various quotations from the Old Testament. In verses 10 to 12, there are general references from Ecclesiastes 7:20, Psalm 14, 2 to 3, Psalm 53, verses 2 to 3, and more particular verses are Psalm 5, 9, Psalm 140, verse 3, Psalm 10, verse 7, Isaiah 59, 7 to 8, Psalm 36, verse 1. And when an individual sees their life as God sees their life, when an individual looks at the Scripture, and at this particular time, the Old Testament, we have the New Testament Scripture today, but at this particular time, they did not have that. But even if you look at the Old Testament and into the New Testament, when you look at the Bible and you see man's condition, the Bible makes it clear, when you look at what God says about the human heart, every mouth is stopped, and all the world stands naked, guilty before God. Every individual. Now, we're talking about the religious. We're talking about those in Africa and those in Quebec City. We're talking about those in Canada and the United States and those in the islands in the South and all over this world. Every single individual is guilty before God, and he is convicted. He is convicted that he is guilty before the Lord. You know, the reality is he doesn't have a defense. I mean, an individual that with an open heart and an open mind looks at what God says and forgets about the tradition of man and what man has taught them, but just looks at the Bible, there is no defense. Every individual is guilty before God. And so he is convicted. He is condemned. He is condemned. Now we know, verse 19, that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them that are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may be guilty before God. You know, you do not have to wait until you die before you find out you're standing before God at the judgment. You can know right now. The Bible says that you're guilty before God. Every mouth is stopped, and all the world is guilty before God. Let me give you a New Testament passage of Scripture, John chapter 3, verse 18. And he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. Already in their sin. The law of God, it shows the condition of man is helpless. But the law of God shows man's case is hopeless. You see, the Bible says in verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin. The reality is it is vain to cling to forlorn help that somehow, that some way, that your good deeds will outweigh your bad deeds, because the Bible makes it clear that that's never going to happen in eternity. We are all guilty before God. We are hopeless in our condition and case. The Bible says that every single man in this world, every individual in this world, we are all guilty before God. We have all sinned. Every mouth is stopped, and every individual is guilty before God. Now, this is what you're thinking. You're thinking, good night, Pastor Burns. The last three sermons, all you've preached about was we're murderers, and we've done all this, and we're just horrible people, and man, that's a lot of darkness for me. I'm never coming to this church again. All you talk about is all the bad things we do. I want you to understand this. Don't miss this. The reason why Paul the Apostle takes three chapters in Romans to describe man's condition is because he wants the gospel light to shine very brightly. And until you understand where we are, Until you understand the condition of humanity, until you understand the hopelessness and the helplessness of the human soul, then you'll truly not understand how precious the gospel of Jesus Christ is. And that is why Paul began this chapter by saying, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation. And let me prove it to you, because this is the human heart. This is where we are. We are living in misery. We are murderers at the heart. We are living in mutiny. There's no fear of God. We are lost and on our way. But Jesus Christ came down. He died for our sins. And now we can have eternal life. And there's no salvation in ritual. There's no salvation in your heritage. I'm glad that you were born in the preacher's home, but that's not going to save you. And I'm glad that you were born in the Christian home, but my friend, that's not going to give you eternal life. And I don't care if you were a Lutheran or a Catholic or a Baptist. It doesn't matter, because it won't save you. What will save you is Jesus and Jesus alone. And that's why the Bible gives us the wonderful, glorious light of the gospel, and it plunges all of the world into sin. And it says every mouth is stopped and everyone is guilty before God. And my friend, you'll never come to Christ unless you realize that you cannot save yourself, and there's nothing that you can do to save yourself. It is only by the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the truth. It is the hope. It is the only way to come to God. And I hope today you know the Lord Jesus as your Savior. I pray today that you're not trusting in a religion. I pray today you're not trusting in a false hope. But I pray today that you're trusting in Christ, because this is what the Bible says. All the world is guilty before God. And we, friend, need the gospel. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your word. And Father, we pray that you would help us. Lord, we thank you for the teaching of the Word of God and the doctrine that we have. Father, I pray that you would help us to see the importance of the gospel of Jesus Christ in our life, but also, Father, for the lives of those that we love and are near to us, that we would preach to them the truth and pray for them. And Father, I pray that they would come to Christ and be saved. We thank you for the revelation of Scripture, the truth that we can have. Father, I pray you would help us to live for you in these days. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take your hymn books together, 249. If you turn there, 249.